Alpha Geek Radio.
Okay.
Wait, Zoe, we must combat the kitty. Come here.
Is this going to be a kitty party?
It's not a cat.
Kitty party?
Come here.
Hold on, let me get my dog.
I got her.
Hey, Zoe. You see the dog? You see the dog? Look at the cat.
That's awesome. The kitty.
Oh, hello. You know what?
I'm making biscuits.
Just have the dog do the show. Hey, you'd be way more entertaining. You probably liked Ark because there's pooping.
That's right. That's the game all my friends are playing on the Minecraft server that I'm a part of. And I laugh all the time because my one friend, when he starts playing, he's like, "You poop!"
Well, it's funny because we'll probably talk a bit about it on the show, but I was,
What?
You can push a button to poop, but sometimes you just poop on demand, by accident.
You just walk around, all of a sudden, boop,
boop. Yeah, you just hear, you have defecated. And I'm like, oh no, I was in someone else's home, and I defecated on their floor.
And I can't even clean it up, they haven't put that in yet.
I felt terrible. You can pick it up. I picked it up and threw it at a saber tooth. He had it coming.
Oh, gosh.
It's been a while since I've used this Google Hangouts business.
You do all Skype stuff, right?
Yeah, I'm going to have to... I just find that it eats the... Maybe I should... I'll close Skype.
It's a good idea. Who uses Skype?
All the time. All the time.
Well, I say that when I'm trying to get some of our shows over to where I can use Skype, but I haven't figured out how to use OBS yet.
Cat typing.
Kitty on keyboards, never good.
Yep.
Hey, we have two viewers already. We haven't even started yet. Not officially.
Hi, two viewers.
So what are the links that we should use? Oh, there we are. Never mind. I see now.
I just retweeted Alpha Geek link.
Hi.
Use that, Ryan.
Are we going to read about Jared Fogle and on the Facebooks? Is that what we're doing now? He like hit something and now there's like Jared all over my screen.
If only I were that lucky. I only saw it in the news feed. I'm like, oh, that's good. That's all I need to see.
Okay.
Or not even the news feed, that side news thing.
Yeah. Yeah, the trending thing. All right. What other news are we going to end up with today? Are we going to go back a page? No?
Oh, I heard a meow.
Yeah, he's walking all over my keyboard. He's got a new message up, and it's going to 8:4/9, and then a couple of brackets. I don't even know who that is. But...
his button. So
Hundar 89 has come up from Jakarta.
There you go.
So they might be getting a message from my cat.
From our cat's butt.
Oh,
all the
now
greatest
it's time to
text.
The weather.
Right, Zoe, all the greatest texts are written from people's butts.
He swiped to the little dashboard screen on the Mac.
Oh, what Funko Pops you got? There's the purple dude.
We've got, okay.
There's
so
a doctor.
So we've got the Vision.
Yeah, that's Vision.
And then, we're back to Jared. And then we have the cigarette smoking man.
Oh, X-Files. Oh, yeah, nice.
The restaurant X-Files.
I was going to say, that guy looks like the doctor.
Would you like the tour?
Yeah, give me the tour. I don't have any Funko. Oh, I have one or two, just Loot Crate ones.
I got two as well, but they're the smaller little ditties.
Oh, I've never seen those before.
Deadpool, I think. Yeah, they're still Funko. It's Deadpool and then Ultron. The just the little like inch box.
And then there's
Pop.
Flash and Captain Cold and Reverse Flash and B9.
Ooh. Should I be watching Flash? I feel like that's a thing I should do.
That's yes. a pretty good show. I highly recommend
it. Oh, yeah, it's an excellent show. It's fun. It's a really fun... It's like a... It's not trying to be a superhero show. It is a superhero show.
Oh, really? Well, that's good.
More action figure.
As the dude who, for the whole season Flash was on, would talk about that, like, on his podcast with Corey. It nailed the first season. And then the funny... do you watch Arrow?
I watched, like, the first half of the first season.
Okay. They write the Flash, and this is, I'm quoting Corey here on this, but they write the Flash a little bit better on Arrow, and they write Arrow better on Flash, which is interesting because it's the same people, like the same writers and stuff, but it's just like, because they've had crossovers and all that, and it's just like a little bit better here, a little bit better there, sort of deal.
Interesting.
It's so funny. I'm trying to get into the Alpha Geek chat room, and it's all in French.
What?
Bonjour.
Really?
Yeah. Which will happen if you're in Canada. Sometimes French pops up.
Stupid Quebecers.
Wow.
Stupid what? Right,
hang on.
Quebecers. That's the part that speaks French.
It's also I heard something else, and I'm not sure what.
It's also where my ancestry comes through.
Home wreckers.
Somewhere in there I heard crackers.
Did you guys mind if we start? Did we do the show? Would you mind if we did?
We can do the show, sure.
Yeah.
All right. Any questions, you guys? Ryan, it's been a while since we changed the format a couple of times, but it's basically back to the way it was.
Okay. Well, I'll try to keep up. I should be all right. I've got the notes up. I've kind of perused, so I think we're good.
Okay. All right. So if you guys are ready, I think we can just dive in. All the levels look fantastic. So let's just get it on, shall we? If you can turn down your mics because I have a pre-produced intro for the show. So let's start it with that, and then I'll jump in and we'll get it going. So here we go. Stand by.
This is Alpha Geek Radio. Visit tunein.alphageekradio.com to learn more.
The following is a presentation of GalacticNetcasts.com.
Attention, Galactic Collective. The Sci-Fi Geeks Club is next.
You can take part in the podcast, but send a message to galacticnetcasts@gmail.com. Call the voicemail number at 805-328-3966, or leave an audio message directly on our website, galacticnetcasts.com. We also invite you to join the Galactic Collective. All the information and links can be found at gncasts.com/galacticcollective. That's gncasts.com/galacticcollective. Now, without further ado, hear ye, hear ye! Another meeting of the Sci-Fi Geeks Club is officially called to order!
Hey everybody, I'm Dave Nelson. Joining me on the host panel this time around is Brad Ludwig, Nessa Moyens, and Gregor Sprague. Gregor, how you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. How are you guys doing?
Great.
Awesome.
Not too bad. It's been a while since we had you on. It's been a while since we had you on as a guest host.
Yes, it's been a while.
Good to have you back.
Thank you for having me.
Our guest geek is actually a returning guest because we've got the guest host. Okay, here's the rules. So, Ryan, listen up. I haven't officially introduced you yet, but here's the rules. You can be a guest twice. Anytime after that, you're a guest host. Because Gregor's been on a number of times, he can't be a guest again. He can be a guest host, but not a guest. So that, right. that's the rules.
Is that in the bylaws?
Did I make the last rule?
Time as a guest. So.
I think I made that rule because the first two times I was on, I was a guest, and then just slowly became guest host.
I think that is quite possible. you may be right. So let me, okay, since it's Ryan's last time, let me do the official introduction. Our guest geek this week is a returning guest geek. He is a contributor to Galactic Netcast, along with the host of the Gamers Inn, Zombies Ate My Podcast, and Sleeping with the Elephant Podcast. Welcome back to the Sci-Fi Geek, Mr. Ryan Murphy. Ryan, how are you?
Good. How are you? Thank you. I'm happy to be here. It's weird. I was not present for the bylaws. Oh, am I cutting in and out?
No, I think it's
Dave.
Oh. I was going to say he's going choppy.
Yeah.
Dave seems to be having some computer issues, perhaps.
It's that Canadian internet, man. What's going on?
Wait a second.
Yeah, wait. Don't worry, I have a direct line to the... I have U.S. internet. No, I don't. Not at all.
I can get you. We can just get an Ethernet cord and probably go to either one of you guys.
Probably. He's right across the street. Well, at least we're still live, right? Although it's probably not recording anymore if his computer went down.
No, but
he moved. Come back.
I'm not here yet. Am I back?
Good, sort of.
You're trying super hard to be back.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
As long as
am I clear?
Okay. What? I don't know. That happens at least every second time that we do, or second or third time that we do Hangouts. So hopefully that's the last time it'll happen during this episode. So, Ryan, what's been happening since the last time we had you on? Catch us up.
Oh. So much. When was the last time I was on? It was like a couple years ago? No.
Yeah, it was like
Maybe it was early.
Early goings for the Sci-Fi Geeks Club.
Probably. Well, I got married. That happened last year. I played a bunch of video games. Do you want me to go in order? There's a lot of them.
Yes, please.
Okay. I'll work backwards. So Batman. Probably another Batman game. It's been a while since I've been on. So not a whole lot. Same old, Gamers in, Zombies Ate My Podcast, Sleeping with the Elephant. Paul and I are still kicking it. I know Paul's a Galactic Netcast buddy. So,
Former alumnus, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you want to just kind of briefly explain each of your podcasts that you're a part of? Just like...
Sure. The Gamers Inn is a weekly video game podcast I record with Jocelyn Moffat of The Angry Chicken, and we sort of discuss games we're playing and pick a topic each week. This last week, and we record Wednesday, so we just recorded last night, and this week we talked about PewDiePie making $7 million and how that is okay, and that he seems to be probably one of the most mature people on YouTube, which is surprising because I watched a couple of his this is why I make $7 million videos, and he's kind of immature, but I think that's what he does, right? That's his thing, and people like that. I'm not a big fan, but I appreciated his video where he explained why it shouldn't be a problem that he makes that amount of money, and I agree with him. Zombies Eat My Podcast I do with Lou and Bob, and we talk about zombies each week. Now we're kind of in a lull where we're like just starving for Comic-Con to get here, to devour whatever news they'll drop. So you know you have your Walking Dead spin-off stuff. So we're looking forward to spoiling Fear the Walking Dead in August, and then of course Sleeping with the Elephant with Paul, where myself as a Canadian and Paul as an American, we compare stories, news stories from each country, and right now we're knee-deep in Donald Trump hair. So, I'm just, as a Canadian, I'm flabbergasted that someone would make it that close to a microphone and actually get a chance to announce that they're running for president. Like, here in Canada, it's like, that's not a thing that happens. Like, crazy people do not get up to the mic. They don't even make it to, like, the party nominations. Like, it's so different, and it cracks me up each time I get to talk about that stuff. So, and we have an election in October, and all we can talk about is an election in the States that's happening 2 years from now because Donald Trump is saying things about Mexico. That is how that show works.
Well, trying to explain the differences between the political systems is hard enough as it is.
Well, ours makes sense, and theirs doesn't, basically, is how it works, right?
Wait, hold up. As a dude who lives in a mitten here, is this that whole, you know, metric imperial thing or whatever?
Exactly. Metric works and imperial doesn't, which is the one we have, the one that works, the centimeters one.
That's metric.
Yeah, metric works and imperial, no, I don't know. Like, I'm a big fan of inches and feet and stuff, and yards, like... A yard is a different field of measurement depending on what is it, your front yard that you're measuring as a yard? Is it your backyard is you're measuring as a yard?
No, it's the side yard.
The side yard? My side yard's like 2 feet. So
there you go.
Wait, how big is a yard? I don't even know.
Three feet?
Really?
That is I am 2 yards high.
What, did the guy, like, the guy that was living in, like, a New York apartment come up with that one? Like, oh, my yard's 3 feet. Great. I mean, cut it. I can do it with tweezers. Man, I don't know.
Right. Ryan, welcome back to the show. Gregor, catch us up on what you got going on these days.
Well, besides the stuff I do for the Galactic Netcast with with the Splash Page podcast and the Splash Page blog, which the blog is daily. And there might be a special Saturday one because of Comic-Con, and then the audio Splash Page podcast, which gets played here occasionally. I'm one of the co-founders of Elsners.com, where we do the, right now we're just doing What Else Is On, which is our TV review show, which Dave is one of the people who started it way back in the day, and then me and Corey just sort of took it over from him and Glenn. The cool thing is Elsners.com isn't actually a website. It just doesn't forward to our YouTube page, and we are on iTunes and Stitcher because...
Oh, you have real web page now, website now. That's cool.
Yes, through WordPress, because I do all the updating and stuff for Splash Page. I'm like, I'm going to do one for us. And it's only the... hey, we're live. This is the show, the audio version as well, which then goes to iTunes and Stitcher. I want to do more. It's just I'm lazy. Like, the comic book podcast, 616, has been on a hiatus for 2-3 months now. When did Convergence start? Because that was the last time I actually covered anything.
March,
right? And then something like that. Pots of the Queen, the British TV show one, has been on a hiatus because the TV shows have been a lot of panel shows, and it would just be like, this is the next one. Hey, insert show here. It was great. That's all they ever are if it's all panel shows. And yeah, that's about it.
And people really need to check out the Splash Page blog because you extensively cover comic book related news, like big time. If you want anything from the actual comic books to the movie properties or the TV shows, you cover it on a daily basis at our website, which is gncasts.com. And you do a hell of a job, and I really appreciate what you do for us. It's cool.
Thank you. And I will give a quickie little one that almost made it in, and that is the news that William Shatner's new comic book, Man of War, is going the cinematic comic book route, and they have like a 6-minute extended preview, and it looks so cool. He does narration in the beginning, and then it's...
Wait a second. He has his own comic book?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that.
It's called Man of War.
And it's being made into a movie?
It's no tech war, but then again, what is?
It's not being made into a movie. I forget the term, but it's like a motion comic where you see like the people move and stuff, but it still has these speech bubbles and like the bang, pow, arg, all that stuff.
Okay.
Yeah, it's really cool. I saw it on YouTube today when I was looking through, trying to narrow it down to 6 stories to cover for today.
All right, cool. Let's get into the news. We've got a lot to cover here, and I started things off with the 3 big Star Wars news stories that came out this week. The first one is Phil Lord and Chris Miller. You may know them from the Lego Movie. They've signed on to direct the origin story that will focus on the early days of a young Han Solo. And the screenplay is being written by Star Wars legend Lawrence Kasdan. And John Kasdan, is that his brother or his son or somebody related to him?
Cousin.
Twice removed.
Yeah. He's got the Kasdan name. I don't know.
Just the guy.
I recognize Lansdowne, whatever his name is. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's his brother. Maybe it's his son.
Somebody
got the same last name. That's the most important.
So are you guys excited about this young Han Solo? Obviously, they have to cast somebody else in the role, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Why does everybody mention Chris Pratt? Like, I love Chris Pratt, don't get me wrong, but I think they're going younger here. Like, I'm thinking,
yeah, they would have to go younger.
20s. Like,
Asa Butterfield.
Oh. That's exactly who I was talking about.
Wait, really? Butterfield, a kid with, like, no emotion? That guy, he'd be a terrible Han Solo.
Okay, I got John Kasdan is Lawrence Kasdan's son.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because...
So he's young. He knows what the kids want.
Yeah, that's Lawrence good. Is up there in age, so maybe he needs somebody to kind of keep him grounded a little bit.
Wheel him around.
Yeah. Right.
Tell me what the youths want to see, son.
Cell
are you still doing the twerking?
It's a far, far time away. What are you doing? I don't know. Like as a young Han Solo, like I think you've got a wide range, and I imagine they go unknown, and that's sort of the trend that they've been doing with these Star Wars. I mean, we've only got 2 that they've started been talking about, but everybody they cast is an unknown except for the original trilogy characters, right? There hasn't and Andy Serkis, I guess, but
and in the original and in the original films, the only really known actor, right, was Harrison Ford. Well, he was
Sir Alec Guinness.
Yeah, that's true.
The guy who complained about making Star Wars while making Star Wars.
Yes.
Yeah. I think you go. They go unknown. That I mean, they aren't. Well, sorry, I almost said they are. They aren't Disney, but they are Disney. But for some reason, Disney doesn't seem to be applying their same Marvel techniques of hiring people we know, like Robert Downey Jr. and Marissa Tomei and whoever's playing Spider-Man. I think they go unknown, similar to what they've done with Rogue One, where it's like all these actors that we've never heard of, and Chris Pratt is just easy. I'm sure Chris Pratt is getting sick of these like articles of like, great, the Uncharted movie is coming up. Of course, my phone's gonna ring. Indiana Jones, like, Chris Pratt is Star-Lord. Just let him be Star-Lord for a bit, you know?
Yeah.
And I will say though that the Marvel comparison is a little bit different because with the exception of Doctor Strange, the Doctor Strange movie. The unknowns have been the main focus. Like, the big supporting... Like, you look at the Netflix Daredevil series, Charlie Cox, virtually unknown. The dude who plays Foggy Nelson, unless you were a kid who watched... And I didn't even realize this until Corey pointed out, but who watched the Mighty Ducks movies, you wouldn't recognize the dude who plays Foggy Nelson.
I thought he looked familiar, and I'm
he's one of the Bash Brothers.
Okay. That makes more sense now.
That is really funny. Now that you say that, I totally see it. That's cool.
Yeah. He was one that was in the first one, I believe, and then got the Bash Brother in the second one. And then the big names were Rosario Dawson in a more supporting character role. It was the dude who played Leland Owlsley, who was in a very supporting, recurring cast member role, and Vincent D'Onofrio. You know, those were your big names in supporting. it's not all of them have been, you know, doing an obscure name and then supporting be filled in. So in a way, they sort of are doing the Marvel route. Mm-hmm. It's just the supporting ones are the big named, you know, dudes. I think Anthony Daniels is in there for C-3PO. But, you know, the big people who were in the original trilogy.
Mm-hmm. So you think they age Ewan McGregor or whatever, however you say his name? That's not how you say his name.
No, well, yeah. Ewan McGregor, he has said that he has interest in playing Obi-Wan Kenobi, but I would imagine that would be something tied more to the prequels, not age him to do, like, to do now. Like, oh, hey, Force Ghost of Obi-Wan.
When are we getting the Star Wars panel at Comic-Con? Because they did say that this came out, this news broke before Comic-Con, and they had said that there's going to be Comic-Con news, like there's more awesome stuff. I don't know if they said it, but people have said it.
Well, today is Star Wars Day, I think, right? Today
oh, is it?
Yeah. So maybe today was the panel. I don't know the schedule.
Today's been weird. Today's been kind of like quiet stuff. I think most of the big stuff's Saturday, right? Like the Hall H stuff. I don't know a whole lot about Comic-Con. I just know that on Monday I get to read a bunch of cool stories.
Or all throughout this week on the Splash Page blog.
Yeah, exactly. Or, you know, on Monday I get to hear about all the trailers I don't get to watch, and then maybe Reddit will let me watch a blurry Batman asking if Superman right. bleeds, which is kind of an odd question.
All right.
No,
go ahead, Gregor, but then we have to move on.
I know Saturday typically is more for like people who are attending. It's more of the cosplay focus, and mm-hmm. I do know, like there might be some other parts going on. Like DC is actually doing a Harley Quinn costume contest at their booth. But yeah, so that's usually how it goes. The event stuff is usually like all throughout the week.
All right.
Okay, that makes sense.
All right, so Darth Vader is set to return in Star Wars Rogue One, according to birthmoviesdeath.com, a writer for the fan site, which was formerly known as Badass Digest, reports that Vader will have a string-pulling background role in the Gareth Edwards film. He will appear on screen, possibly remotely via view screen or holo projection, but will not be the main antagonist in the movie. So, there you go. You guys excited to see Star Wars back? Darth Vader?
Just as a quick update, the Star Wars panel is this evening.
Okay. So
we should have recorded like a couple hours.
Either that or it's tomorrow morning, but people are lining up already for the panel. So.
Oh, that may be tomorrow morning then. That's quite possible.
They have a San Diego Comic-Con Funko Pop exclusive of Conan O'Brien dressed as Batman.
They have four. They have four different versions. Regular, Batman, zombie, and I think robot.
Nice.
Are you guys?
And if you enter on the website, you can get free ones.
Are you guys interested at all in this Darth Vader being back on Rogue One in a ancillary role?
No.
Okay.
You know, it's easy, right? You just put some guy in a suit. They already have a guy who can basically emulate Darth Vader's original voice actor. What's his name?
James Earl Jones, who's still alive.
How did I forget? He is still alive, but he's expensive as hell, right? It's that CNN talent, right?
Star Wars! It's Disney! It's Lucasfilm! Yeah. They have the money!
Yeah, but they don't want to spend the money. You mean there's Disney's notorious for penny pinching, and there's a reason they're putting out a new Star Wars film each year, and it's because they're going to make big bank. And I think I'm not saying they're doing this. I'm obviously joking, but they'll get James Earl Jones to do the one or two lines. They'll pay him however they need to pay him. But do you think they get that Adam Christensen or whatever his name? What's his name? What's the guy's name? That
Adam Driver.
Hayden.
Can't remember his name.
Hayden Christensen.
Hayden Christensen. Yeah. Do you think they get him back in the suit? Because he'd be pretty ripe at that point.
Because you're putting a helmet on him, so why pay a known actor? Well, he's not really known for anything else.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, Jumper. I mean, come on, that was.
Oh, he was.
Yeah,
oh,
all five people saw.
No, it was a horrible film. The only thing
Jumper was actually filmed over like just two blocks that way. The library scene is filmed here at the Peterborough Library, and I don't know why I'm bragging about that. Suddenly,
Well, that was a big deal, probably.
Well, it kind of was, because they basically, like, fake flooded the library, so all the people who hated books were like, sweet, down with books.
I don't know.
It's not on the, like, welcome to Peterborough sign, but I know it's one of the bigger movies that have filmed here in Peterborough, so it's interesting. It's a factoid.
All right, third Star Wars story. There's a Star Wars app now. It's your one-stop portal for everything from news to trivia to sound effects to GIFs. I guess you can like make yourself appear in pictures with like stormtroopers, apparently. And there's also a countdown to the next movie. So there's a countdown for Star Wars Episode 7, The Force Awakens. Then there'll be a countdown for Rogue One, and so on and so on.
Everything needs an app, right?
This one is the one, like the other two, I'm more interested in, the other two stories. But this one, it's just like, all right, cool, it's a Me Too feature. Like, oh, we got an app. You know, well, yeah, so does everyone. My 12-year-old cousin just made an app the other day.
But you know what, Gregor? Well, it's kind of a big deal because this is the first time Star Wars has done an app, like an official app.
Yeah, which is good and true. And because it is Star Wars, I could see the countdown thing coming and working better than Ant-Man's coming out, or like, you know, earlier on where it's like, oh, we got an app or and whatever, and it has a countdown. And then eventually it'll start going up after it's been released because we don't plan on releasing a sequel.
Right. Do you guys remember the iPhone app and what was once a MacBook app that was like turn your device into a lightsaber, and then when you like swung it, it'd go like. So this has a soundboard, so I feel like this would be the perfect tool to like annoy my wife and make lightsaber sounds,
mm-hmm.
and like cut out the middleman. I don't even have to make them. I can make my phone make the sounds.
Yes. Perfect.
Make the Chewie sound. Storm Blaster Blast, R2-D2 Scream. I mean, come on. Like, soundboards are pretty cool.
Yeah. Anessa, I know that you're big into apps. Would you get this? I know that you're not that much of a Star Wars fan, but would you get it?
If it was free?
I think it is.
Yeah. It's free. It's got to be free.
I might check it out, but I don't know that I would keep it on my phone. I would just get it to play with it for all of 5 minutes and then probably delete it.
All right. Fair enough. Brad?
Would I get it?
Or anything. Any thoughts on this?
No, I'd rather be kicked in the testicles than see Darth Vader appear again.
All righty. Yeah, he's
so incensed by the second story that he's still thinking about it.
I'm going to be honest with everybody here. I saw episode one, and I felt like Lucas peed all over me. I saw episode two, and I'm like, I can't believe I fell for it again. And I have not, to this day, seen the third film because I refuse to have George Lucas poop in my mouth again. Oof. No.
Then don't see Crystal Skull. It's going to do much worse.
I saw Crystal Skull, and I felt like I was betrayed yet again.
But this isn't Lucas. This is Star Wars. This is what I've been looking forward to because I didn't grow up on Star Wars. I sort of just watched them by proxy. And then I watched 1, 2, and 3, and it's like, sure, more of that. Great. Maybe if you ignore Jar Jar Binks, it's a little easier to say that. But then when I see episode 7 and think J.J. Abrams is directing, I'm like, finally, this is the Star Wars movie for me because I get to go to theaters and have that experience that people had when they went to see episode 4 and 5 and 6.
Yes. Don't get me wrong. I am going to see episode 7.
Mm-hmm.
I stand firmly by not seeing episode 3. If it's on and nobody I know has paid to see it while I'm in that room, because I'll be goddamned if I'm going to see Lucas get any of my money to watch that POS. Not doing it.
He's got plenty of everybody else's money.
He's got plenty of it.
Yeah.
All right. Go ahead.
That's it. I'm out. We can talk about the next thing.
Yeah, I know that you're very excited about this, Brad, because you're a fan, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Farscape movie is happening, according to Rockne O'Bannon. I love his name. He confirmed this when he was part of a panel at WonderCon And then Nerdacy.com, I love that website name, then spoke to O'Bannon, who confirmed that the script is currently being written by former writer for the series, Justin Monjo. Oh my God, this is a great story. All these great names. There's currently no word whether or not the original cast will return.
Seems like those names could essentially be characters in this show, judging by the thumbnail they have on the article. That weird squid face could be Magumbo.
I thought I saw that they were getting, that they're essentially sort of, not necessarily rebooting it, but they were going to get the original cast back.
Let's review the original cast, because a couple of the actors and actresses have gone on to do other things. Like, the main guy he eventually became a cast member on Stargate SG-1, right?
Yes. And, Claudia Black was on that as well.
Yeah. And she's gone on to do different things as well, I believe.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
What is Farscape? That's the thing that I...
Okay. In a nutshell, Farscape follows John Crichton, who is a test pilot / scientist who has been theorizing about wormholes and being able to do interstellar travel at great distances by using wormholes. Mm-hmm. And they create a ship. And, of course, now the name of the ship, Farscape 1, duh. They get it ready to launch, and they actually had designed it on a NASA replacement, like a concept drawing of a NASA replacement for the space shuttle. And it is a single-person craft, and he launches into space, and a wormhole opens up, and an alien craft comes shooting out of... I'm sorry. He gets... something happens with the wormhole. He gets sucked into it. And then he's in the middle of this huge battle. And mm-hmm. he is God knows where in... He could be in another galaxy completely. He has no idea where he is in the universe. And then the wormhole closes.
Okay, so it's like a Lost in Space kind of thing. All right.
Sort of, but the cool thing about it is your second episode is him having to come to terms with the fact that he is the alien. Nobody's ever seen a human being. I mean, there's a race called the Sebaceans, which look like humans, but he doesn't understand this portion of where he's at in space. So there's a whole political structure. There's a whole... I mean, he looks like these Sebaceans, and Sebaceans are hated. So he's thinking that he's going to be able to just sort of, hey, I'm John Crichton, I'm a nice guy, and it doesn't work that way. So you get to experience, you know, in the first season, this universe through his eyes, and have that whole fish out of water experience, and him having this just... not necessarily luck, but his common sense and his instincts are pretty solid. And all the rest of the castmates, he ends up being on a ship, which was actually a prison ship. So it's like all sorts of wackiness ensues, and now he's on the run with these other misfits. And
is it like a Hitchhiker's Guide funny, or is it a serious show? It looks like funny show.
It's more serious.
Oh, okay.
I guess there are funny moments. Yeah, I mean, there have been a couple. Like, to keep his sanity, sort of, he ends up, like, naming some of these repair droids that are on this biological craft that they're all on, and he ends up, you know, and naming them after the Three Stooges.
Okay, that's kind of so. You can make an interesting movie out of it. I mean,
yeah.
I kind of feel like sci-fi is sort of, it's not as run down as the zombie genre, but we're not getting a lot of like big sci-fi releases that are original. I mean, last year we had Interstellar, and I'm not really thinking of any others. There's certainly more of them than zombie films, but this would make a great film, and I think people would dig it if they went super serious and you know, took the idea of being trapped on the other side of a wormhole and not cast Matthew LeBlanc, and you'd be fine.
Matthew McConaughey, yeah.
Matthew McConaughey would be great. I won't see him.
Brad, have you heard if Henson's involved with the movie?
I have not, but it would be a crying shame if he was, if they were not.
Yeah, because Ryan, the Jim Henson company did a lot of the alien creatures in this movie, so that's why they look very puppet-like or Muppet. Yeah.
Well, there's they do a lot. They do some because there's one character who is a puppet that is like has a floating platform, but they do a lot of makeup and practical effects, and they're very well done because they're not just a puppet shop. They're also a practical effects studio as well, and what they did was pretty spectacular for the kind of budget that they had to work with.
What was
Jim Henson does a really good job, like that shop does a really good job of creating these puppets. I mean, I remember Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy when they made that film and they went puppets. It was just, that movie remains probably one of my favorite sci-fi films, and I've never read the books, but I love that film, and this looks like it could be really cool. And you know, we're not getting the sci-fi puppet treatment very much these days, and there's still talk that, I mean, evidently someone's hiring Jim Henson's production company because they're still around, so it'd be really cool to get more of that on the big screen with Farscape. I think that'd be really cool.
Well, at this point, Henson's studio is owned by Disney, so...
Right. So, once again, Disney owns everything we've talked about on the show.
Well, they don't own Star Trek yet, which is our next topic.
Yes.
Yet.
Yeah, yet. So you can now own a Star Trek communicator to use as just your phone. It doesn't come out until next year, but you can pre-order it for $149.95 from the Star Trek shop. It is a Bluetooth-enabled speaker-type device that you can, whenever your phone rings, you can open it and use it just like the Star Trek communicator.
Sure.
I so want that.
Yeah.
Just to be that guy to be out like in the mall or something like that and have it beep, 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 flip it open.
I hope it makes
sense. Do you have to talk slowly into it so it understands you? Like, split your sentences up?
No, see, Brad, you're going about this a little bit wrong, though, because what you got to do is have it set up to where the ringtone is a Star Wars sound, and to where all the nerds go, what, why, where they see
nerd,
you open up...
Nerd heads explode.
Why would
everywhere?
You do that?
Just be like, I love Doctor Who.
Oh. It's like, let me just answer my TARDIS real quick.
It's like that picture of, Patrick Stewart?
Yeah.
That's
use the force, Harry.
Yeah.
Well, there's a link that I posted on my Facebook page to a T-shirt that had, was it a Dalek?
Yes.
It was like Doctor Who, Star Trek, and Star Wars is what it made reference to.
Yeah, it was like I was mentioning R2-D2, and it's a picture of a Dalek and something else.
Yeah.
It was ridiculous.
So.
And I was this close to buying it.
Oh gosh, Brad, why didn't you?
Well, because I've only got so much money, and now I got two more little mouths to feed here. So,
yeah.
Well, start saving up for that $150 to get the Star Trek communicator. It's almost an exact duplicate of the original. Like they 3D modeled it.
Yeah, it's essentially a hero prop. I mean, it is. All the dimensions, everything is taken from an original communicator.
And not the J.J. Abrams verse Star Trek either. It's
original. It is made out of aluminum, and it is made out of high-quality injected plastics and high-quality electronics inside of it, and it better be. So.
Mm-hmm. $150, that's a pretty big investment.
It is, but if you're that much of a Star Trek fan... and you're willing to spend that kind of money, which there are a lot of people that absolutely would, myself included, $150 is nothing. I mean, think about this. Now, this is my work phone, but I know for a fact that this was probably about $350, $400. So $150 is really nothing compared to an actual phone.
A Bluetooth speaker is expensive. So if they're going for quality here, like a Bluetooth speaker that you can speak into that receives your voice well enough and spits it back out, like I have just a Bluetooth like Pebble thing here. It was $30 and it's a decent speaker, but the microphone's crap and doesn't pick up worth a dime, right? So $150, you're paying for Star Trek, you're paying for the technology. So I'd probably wait for a review and see how the speaker and the receiving and outgoing sound is. And then from that end, that you can sort of weigh, okay, is the $150 strictly for the name and look? Because it looks like really well built. Like, you could use that as a prop if you wanted to. Like, if you were to, you didn't want to build a Star Trek communicator, you could just buy that one, and $150 is nothing if you're trying to get a really good-looking communicator.
And if you're making your own fan film, problem solved. Sure. You know, and you can use it. You could use it to actually in the movie, in your little web film, your little fan film, you can use it to talk to somebody. It's a perfect solution.
You can make that YouTube money, and then it pays for itself.
Yeah. All right. Let's do one final story. The cult hit artificial intelligence film The Machine being adapted as a new series at the Sci-Fi Channel. Are you guys familiar with the movie The Machine?
No.
I must not be a part of this cult.
I thought it was The Time Machine when I first quickly looked at it, and I thought, I kind of like that film. But it's not at all like that. It's not about time travel, is it?
It's about robots. Yeah. It's about artificial intelligence, transhumanism, the works. And it's going to be based on the 2013 film about a brilliant computer programmer who is desperate to save his terminally ill daughter, creates the first ever piece of self-aware artificial intelligence. Of course, things go horribly wrong when the government hijacks the AI originally designed to help injured soldiers and uses it to create the ultimate cyborg killing machine. The Hollywood Reporter says that the machine will follow several storylines as it takes a broad view of cutting-edge scientific breakthroughs in genetics, engineering, transhumanism, and artificial intelligence.
Weird. Yeah, I never heard of this film. It looks cool, though, based on the photos. So, yeah, I'm all for more SciFi doing something that isn't Sharknado and whatnot. That's good.
They're kind of on a roll right now. They've got two really good shows, Dark Matter and Killjoys. Then they've got The Expanse coming up, which is based on a really good series of books. And then they've got a... what's the one with the aliens? Brad?
Could you be more specific?
Oh, the alien one. Ascension. No, that's not it.
Ascension, although, Dominion.
I know what you're Defiance. Talking about. It's a video game. It's
Defiance.
Yes.
No, it's not Defiance. It's one based on a book by a pretty well-known sci-fi author, and I forget the name.
Oh, Childhood's End. You're talking about Arthur C. Clarke.
Yeah.
No, so there, well, if you were a little more specific, I could have answered that.
You know, the thing with the guy, that stuff?
That's the thing, yeah.
You know, Vanessa
read it. I mean, like, oh, yeah.
Yeah, my mind is not what it used to be. Sorry. <That's okay.
laughs> This Killjoys, is it any good? It's Canadian here. It's got Aaron Ashmore, the guy who freezes in X-Men.
Nope, that's his brother.
Really?
Yep.
Oh, man.
Aaron Ashmore was in Warehouse 13. He was also in Smallville as Jimmy Olsen. He's a really great actor, and he's great in the series. The wife and I really love it a lot.
The reason he looks exactly like that other dude is because they're identical twins.
Oh, wow. Holy crap. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
They're clones.
Exactly.
From the future.
One was in the hit show Animorphs, the other one wasn't. So
That's not true. The other one was in there as a stunt double for one scene.
Really? What was that, just like a bring your brother to work day or something?
No, yeah, it's pretty much what it was.
Well, he's probably looking for getting his foot in the door into entertainment or trying to get an acting gig.
If I remember correctly, I think it was Sean Ashmore that was in Animorphs, and I remember this one little bit of trivia that his brother was in one scene where he actually turned at camera sort of deal, and I don't remember if it was like the people on set were okay with it or whatever, but it's just like, hey, here's his brother. No one ever noticed because they're spitting images.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
no, that's
Animorphs.
And Ryan, you're right. It is a Canadian. Well, I think it's a joint Canadian production with SciFi.
Aren't they?
All? Most good entertaining SciFi shows are.
Yeah, filmed in Vancouver,
with space.
Made to look like Seattle. That's you just created every single SciFi show.
All right, so there you go. That's our news. If you want more news, by the way, you can check out the SciFi Geeks sheet at our website, galacticnetcast, or gncast.com. That's the easiest one, gncast.com. We do it 3-4 times a week, just the latest sci-fi news. It's called the Sci-Fi Geek Sheet. And let's move on to the big question. We usually have the big questions, usually like one question that we all kind of chime in with our thoughts on. But I thought since we have Ryan and Gregor, who both do things for us, of course, the Galactic Gaming News and the Splash page. So let's kind of, what I wanted to do is ask you guys the biggest video game and comic book related stories in the past week, or maybe not the biggest, but your favorite stories in the last week regarding your specialty, video games or comic books in Gregor's case. So who
wants to go first? I'll defer to Ryan. Go first. Ryan, go first.
Okay. So obviously recording before, I forgot to mention Galactic Gaming News and sort of the rundown of what I do. It's the baby of everything I do. So it gets overlooked, but occasionally it's nipping at everybody's heels, but it's a lot of fun to do. And I basically take three stories and recap them. So I've actually pulled, if I was going to record GGN right now, I pulled three stories that we would do. But obviously with Comic-Con, there's going to be big stuff coming. So this is just small fry stuff. So we can discuss one, but here are three. So you got Call of Duty Black Ops 3 Zombie Mode, which is set in the 1940s. You've got Futurama mobile game. I don't know what it'll be, but whatever. And there's not much information on it. And then all of the doctors in Lego Dimensions, voiced by Peter Capaldi.
Yeah, we talked about that on the Alien Invasion podcast tonight.
Oh, well, you already know about that one. Then.
Yes, because Brad was upset because in the article they say it's the Doctor Who's.
The Doctor Who's. No.
They don't call him just the Doctor. It's...
They're all the Doctors.
The Doctor Who's. And on their Facebooks.
Preach it, Gregor.
Twitters.
Yeah.
All I know is that I'm not going to buy Dimensions, but I'm certainly going to buy whatever Doctor Who Lego there is that goes with it, and the Portal stuff and all that stuff. But okay, we'll remove that one. Why don't we dig it? You know, the one I know most about and has the most information is this Call of Duty.
Yeah, Black the Call of Duty 3. One, because didn't they announce some actor who's going to be in it?
You've got your four actors. So set in the 1940s, and it features Jeff Goldblum, Heather Graham, Neil McDonough, and Ron Perlman, playing a magician, femme fatale, cop, and boxer. I mean, we all know who the femme fatale is, and that's Jeff Goldblum.
Ron Perlman.
I was going to say Ron Perlman.
Yeah? Well, he's the boxer, actually, and kind of the one that actually looks like the actor. I didn't quite picture Jeff Goldblum as the magician, but I guess that's who he is. And it's set in the 1940s. It's very, like... It's got all the VO set in that timeline as well. And the reason it's sort of sci-fi is that, like, obviously Call of Duty Black Ops 3 takes place in the future, and it's nice that they've sort of done the opposite of what we got in the last Call of Duty Advanced Warfare, where they took zombie mode and put it in the future. This one takes zombie mode and puts it in a cool timeline with the 40s and mafia-inspired and just really over-the-top, hammy stuff. And I don't know, I haven't played a zombie mode in a while, but I'm a huge fan of the original zombie mode. Have you guys played any of the zombie mode before?
Nope. No, I was on, when I was playing Call of Duty, I was on the Modern Warfare part, like I would do those. which was basically up until Modern Warfare 3, and then I just quit playing it because of a tilt scratch on the 360. But and so then afterwards, I know like the I think the first redo of Zombie Mode, they had Rucker in there and a few other people. So is this like an every other year thing that they're going to do, where they're going to get big name people to do Zombie Mode?
Well, it's actually ever since Infinity Ward basically became a shell of its former self, Zombie Mode has sort of been shoehorned into every Call of Duty game. And Treyarch, obviously being the ones behind the mode originally, sorry, I lost my train of thought. They are the ones that originally did it in World of War, and they're sort of considered the godfathers of Zombie Mode. So this is like the true return, whereas with Advanced Warfare, that was a different team sort of using that setup. So it'll be interesting. I haven't played a Zombie Mode in a while, but this one actually looks unique and fun and different from everything else that Black Ops 3 has to offer. So
yeah, and this is good because I think this one, because the one I was referring to was Treyarch's last Zombie Mode that they did, where it was more of a story mode in there, where you had, they announced, like, again, like four big name actors, like it was Michael Rooker and like a few other people. I can't think of who they were doing voices throughout the whole story.
Mm-hmm. Well,
yeah, so I think it's like, yep, sorry, say that again?
No, I was just trying to be funny. I said Aaron Ashcroft.
Oh, no, yeah. But no, I think it's Treyarch that's doing that now, which makes it understandable because before it was Infinity Ward, like, oh, yeah, if you want the good one, you go to Infinity Ward. That's where they get the innovation. And then Treyarch,
they're all the same now. It's just a big factory of Call of Duty spit up. Like, it's kind of how it works. And I'm not sort of poking light at people who love Call of Duty each year. Hey, if that's your game, that's your game, right? Everybody has different tastes, but
there are better games out there.
There are, but you could say that about any game. But really, when it comes to Call of Duty, you have to acknowledge the fact that they are manufacturing this as a yearly franchise. The game runs fine. They're not pulling an Ubisoft where it comes out and it's trash. But they're solid. They run. The single player content is questionable, but most people are buying it for the multiplayer. And they've sort of gone into the future, and they're not looking back when it comes to the setting. So it's going to be sci-fi all day long with this Call of Duty. So
it'd be cool to see zombies in the 1940s, because you don't really zombies in the 1940s.
Exactly. I really do appreciate that they're going back, you know, instead of going forward with the zombie mode. And all the zombies have, like, the 40s get up with the suits and the ties and the baller hats and stuff. It's really cool. It looks really good, too. Like, they've actually put a lot of effort into this mode, which is nice because I think the original mode was just sort of a tacked on, hey, you beat the game, now there's zombies. What? So it'll be interesting.
Hey, Ryan, before we move on to Gregor, is there anything that they're going to be announcing at Comic-Con as far as video game-related stuff, or do they keep that like for E3 and those kind of conferences?
I know there are video game companies there. Like, Nintendo's got a big showing, but it's more so for, like, demoing product. But when it comes to Comic-Con, it's mostly just, like, tie-in stuff, right?
Like the Warcraft, and TV. Right? That's the big thing this year.
Yeah, so there's right now Warcraft, and I'm kind of dreading the fact that there will be a trailer, but I won't be able to watch it, which I think is ridiculous. But Warcraft's the big video game thing. I don't think you'll see any big game announcements because Comic-Con's like a week after E3, and then, well, no, it's about a month after E3, but then you have Gamescom in August when they'll save it. So unless it's a tie-in for a movie or a TV show or it's just a game about a comic book property, I don't foresee seeing big announcements. But I imagine we'll get some Star Wars news on video games, probably. They'll probably have some Star Wars news. Seems to be all the rage these days.
Your Battlefronts and all that stuff.
Yeah, Battlefront. There's word that we should get some sort of look at the game that Amy Hennig is making at Visceral, which is the woman behind Uncharted. She did the first three Uncharted. I think she was lead writer or developer. But there's word that she might they might drop some hints as to what that is, but there's no concrete information yet.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Gregor, do you want to talk about your big comic book related story or stories from the past week, or one that captured you?
A quick pick for the one that I saw before. I'm like, oh hey, we could talk about this as a story. Is Batman is writing Batman. So there's my headline for it. Ben Affleck is writing with Jeff Johns the script for
Jeff Johns.
Yeah. With for the Batman movie, which I'm like, oh, that's cool, because you got Jeff Johns, who's DC's COO, I believe, and Ben Affleck, who's become a very good director with his past like two or three movies, and is an award-winning director, or not director, writer with Good Will Hunting, so it's like we know he can do these things, and sounds like he's fully developing the Batman role. But the other ones that I really want to mention were Dark Horse and United Cable Properties have announced a TV deal, which basically the ones that they've picked so far to get TV shows. There's one I'm really excited for. There's others Brad might be excited for. But you get Harrow County, The Umbrella Academy, which is one I'm really excited for, Backup and Concrete. You can see these anywhere on the Universal Comcast owned shows or networks, if not, and on other places. And I'm sitting right now, Umbrella Academy would probably be really good on Syfy.
What is that?
Just with how... Umbrella Academy is, it's created by Gerard Way, the lead singer of My Chemical Romance, and also the writer of The True Life of the Fabulous Killjoys. Also did a really good take on Spider-Man for the Edge of Spider-Verse event. But it's these kids who all are like connected telepathically in a way. That's how it starts. But then they grow up, and their dad dies, and it's. It's trippy, and how, like, cause, and it's been a while since I've read it. To get it in mind, I'm like, one of them's like turns into a bad guy, and it's just really good. There's a couple of issues in there that I read them like songs, like much like I did with his True Life of the Fabulous Killjoys. Like I read them like, okay, he's doing a My Chemical Romance song, mm-hmm. sort of deal, and it's one of those like I would love to see that translated into TV, especially if Gerard Way is involved in it and in some like producer writer role, just to see how, like, to make sure that it's not becoming a bastardized version of his baby. The other three titles in there, though, I don't really know too much about, but it's, hey, I look at that as a good thing. Like, I mean, there's other titles that people will get in that we'll find and go to the source material. And then the other story that I saw, it was a while back ago, but they talked a little bit about it, is Marvel announced like 45 titles to come out in October, like starting in October, post-Secret Wars. And there's one that I'm really excited for because of the creative team on there. And it's Old Man Logan, and the writer, I'm trying to scroll down to find it. It's written by Jeff Lemire, and the art is done by Andrea Sorrentino. And I love that duo because that was the duo that did Green Arrow last year, 2 years ago during the New 52, and it was a great run. Jeff Lemire took over from someone who messed up the character really, really bad, messed up the whole story, and then made it a great story and set up for what's going on over there with DC now, and I'm excited to see how he does this with Old Man Logan.
What's the story with Old Man Logan? Is that Wolverine now that he's aged? Is that the deal with that story?
Yep.
Yeah. Brad can probably go in the original one because I'm the only one I've really read is the one that's going on with Secret Wars right now. But it's basically Logan's aged quite a bit. There's a lot of villains, I guess, in the book, like Mysterio. I think Red Skull's in there or something like that. Because all the other heroes, there was this big event where all the other heroes died. It's like him and I think Emma Frost are the only two heroes that are in there. But it should be interesting, because I think they're going more off of the Secret Wars, Battle Worlds, Old Man Logan, where you have more heroes in there. Like, I think Hawkeye's in there and all this. And I'm going on this mainly for the art, because and with how they work well together. And it's one of these things, like, when you see when it was Green Arrow, like a punch or a throw, it went almost to the Mortal Kombat X-ray thing, where you would see the like it go to the skeleton and how it affects the skeletal structure sort of deal, which doing Wolverine, I could see that working wonderfully on that.
Does he still have his powers? Yeah. Does he? I know he aged, but does he still have his claws?
There's a few variables with that, because they're basically admitting that they're bringing back Wolverine after Charles Soule's Death of Wolverine storyline, and so you could have where he has his powers. But Brad, help me out. Did you read the original Old Man Logan?
No, I didn't.
Okay,
because I don't kind of not been interested in Marvel for a while at that point.
Yeah. Because I don't remember if the original story, if he had his powers, or if it was some limited thing, like it's just barely keeping him alive sort of deal, but if you were to get mortally, fatally shot or something.
All right. Would you like to know the details?
Sure.
Yes, please.
Let's see. United States has been conquered and divided by amongst supervillains. Abomination, Magneto, Dr. Doom, and Red Skull, who has named himself president. Heroes have been wiped out of existence, and there are a few survivors left in hiding. Logan lives with his wife Maureen and young children Scotty and Jade on a barren plot of land in Sacramento, California, now a part of a territory known as Hulkland. Logan needing money to pay rent to his landlords. Don't want to know. Accepts a job from a now blind Hawkeye to help him travel east to the capital of New Babylon and deliver a secret passage, which Logan assumes to be drugs. Let's see. I don't want to give that away.
Spoilers.
Throughout the story, it is reiterated that the Wolverine persona died the day the villains attacked, and Logan has refused to use his claws ever since. So he's got his claws, he's got his ability to heal, but he just doesn't want to do it anymore.
Okay.
And he would have tried. He tried to kill himself, but he couldn't actually do it because he's Wolverine.
That had to suck.
Yeah. So, that's pretty much it. Okay. I don't want to give away any other details. It looks like it would be an interesting story. I'm really upset with Marvel for, and DC for that matter. DC had a perfectly viable universe when they rebooted it before they did the new 52. It was perfectly structured. They had everything set, and then they did this convergence nonsense, and I think it was really for the sake of copyright law, that they had some characters that they wanted to still be able to keep and use and not have DC or somebody else.
Where that might be true, and I remember getting like almost wanting to yell at the computer when you and Corey were talking about this. I'm like, no, because right now with the stories since then, it's still basically been the new 52. It's just they've now shifted focus away from other areas in the new 52, and focusing more on, like, I know, like, Martian Manhunter's got a book, Cyborg's gonna have a book coming out, and focusing more on them instead of where they've been support characters or in a group book.
That is an excuse.
Yeah.
They had everything firmly in line once that was done. And now Marvel wants to reboot their universe, and I can understand why to a degree. But when they, and God damn it, they both did it. They're not, oh, this person's going to die and they're never coming back. Bullshit. You and I both know that you are going to bring this back, and I'm sorry to add more editing to this, but I'm incredibly passionate about it. the Captain Marvel case proves that they're not going to give up Wolverine. That's stupid. And for them to come out and like when they killed Superman, when Superman died in the early 90s, one of the customers came up to me and said, "Is Superman really dead?" And I looked him right in the eye with no sense of joy, laughter, or anything, and I go, "Give it 3 months." And I was right. Give or take a few months. But there was no way they were going to give that up. And it's so preposterous to think people are that stupid that they're going to give that up. And it's just a cash grab. And it's sad, and it's utter disrespect to the people that spend their money to buy their product, to have them look them in the eye and lie to them and suck money out of their wallet and giggle all the way to the bank. It is so rude and inappropriate, I think, to loyal fans to do that.
Yeah.
And
I might be coming from an odd sort of, I'm not a comic book reader, but, and I understand there's a lot of great stories that the comics are telling, but kind of like a movie person. I'm like, oh, they're telling Civil War. I've heard so much about it. I can't wait to see it. But I could go out and I think that when they announced Civil War, they're like, here are the comics that you can read in order to kind of get the gist of what Marvel's Civil War event was, right? And I think if you're knee deep in the comic book universe, like that's awesome that they're coming up with all these great stories. And yeah, rebooting, yeah, can be seen as sort of a cash grab, but I also think it's a good way to reboot and be like, okay, let's tell some of these stories again for new audiences, because these comic books have been around since the 70s, right? Spider-Man's like he's in his 50s now, right? He's up there. And yes, they're going to tell the origin story over and over and over again, but they can put new spins on it, like with Miles Morales and all the other different Spider people, you know?
Yeah.
I think it's a double-edged sword. You're right. Like, of course it's a cash grab. Of course it's kind of like, oh, but you were getting so good with the game. Like, at a certain point, you're kind of like, you've got your Spider-Man web, and you're just lost. Like, where do I start as Ryan Murphy, never read comics before? Like, do I start at Batman 707, or was it a great time to jump in at Batman number one? Or now that Marvel's rebooted Amazing Spider-Man, or what is it, Spider-Man number one, and see the Miles Morales story from...
There's both now.
Book one. Yeah, there's both, right?
Yeah, there's Amazing...
You got Peter Parker and Miles Morales.
Yeah, you still have Peter Parker, but with how it sounds, and that's because that's the Dan Slott written book, and he's been writing Spider-Man for the past 3-4 years now. And this is coming from the not quite jaded, no offense, Brad.
No, I'm horribly jaded, and I'll be the first to admit it.
This is coming from the not jaded perspective, comic book reader, because I'm still fairly young to it. I think I've been reading comics for like 3 years now. And it's like, it's one of those things, like, I do understand, you know, yeah, dead does not mean dead. Like, when you got, like, the last big death that happened was Batman, and you got Scott Snyder going, oh, 10 issues, he'll be back. It's like, okay. I see that because he then also said Joker will be back. Spoilers for Endgame. Sorry.
They always come back. Unless they're actually dead, in which they like, a comic book series is never ending, right?
No, yeah.
It's comic books are so easy to produce. They're so inexpensive that you don't need to finish it, right? You can just keep going. And when it comes to TV and movies, it's different, right? You can kill things off and be like, no, he's not coming back because we're only going to make 4 more Iron Mans. That's not a spoiler for Iron Man 3, people. Don't worry.
I think the biggest problem is the editorial. If you don't have a strong editorial staff that overlooks, not micromanages, but overlooks and plots out, okay, we've signed you up for a year-long contract, and you've given us a story proposal, and this is what we're going to do. Great. But you need to, and I'm really angry about all the misstarts that they did with the Metal Men in DC. They had a great miniseries that they did in the early 2000s. It reinvigorated the characters. It added a new Metal Man that was desperately needed. The only other female character that they had in there was vapid and fairly worthless and was just there to fawn over their creator and be somewhat comedy relief. And they added Copper. And Copper was sort of a, for lack of a better term, a grounded character. It was female, was smart, little bit of insecurity, but each of the different robots had their own quirk. And that was okay. And then that miniseries, and I feel really bad that I don't recall who wrote it at this point in time, really well written. And then they, I think it was probably about 6 months before they reappeared in, I think, a Batman comic book. And Copper was in there. And then, oh, that's great. They kept it. They kept the team. They've kept this whole dynamic, and they've done really well. And then they brought in Giffen and DeMatteis to do a miniseries and just peed all over all that work that they had done, made the Copper character a joke, and all because the editorial staff didn't have the balls to say, okay, we've done something that was somewhat economically viable. We got good response from it, and we can keep going forward with that. And they just, you know, you bring in those two jackasses, and everything becomes a joke. And it just, and you get that happening over and over, and then you get people that say, well, I'm creatively, my hands are tied. You know, if we could do away with some of this backstory and all this origin crap and just redo everything, everything would be fine. And to me, that's a cop-out. You know, if you're a good writer, you can actually go back and look at some of these older stories and actually find tidbits of what other people have either alluded to or the consequences of actions that had never gone back to being done and make something wonderful and not have to go back and just destroy the whole universe. And I'm kind of jaded because I've got 6,000 comic books in my basement that I'm about ready to light on fire because both of those companies have really just, one, they're worthless. Two, I take that back. There are some that I would gladly go back and read, and they do bring me joy. I won't go that far, but let's not get crazy here.
Yeah, no. I take it outside to burn first. But, what are you doing?
Oh, good call. Good call.
Yeah. I don't want to. But no, yeah, you're making a valid point. Like, but, you have that, you're invested, and it feels like DC's like, we can't solve this. Throw it out, you know?
Well, and I'll be the first to admit, DC and Marvel owe me nothing. They owe me nothing. They can do whatever the hell they want to with their characters. It's their property, it's their choices, and that's fine. But also know, now that I'm an older comic book reader and I have potentially more cash to spend on their property as opposed to reinvigorating something and appealing to a younger audience for the sake of a younger audience, you are kind of giving up one thing for another. And that...
True, but at the same time...
To me, it's not smart.
But at the same time, though, like you look at the audience that has read Batman since the beginning or read Batman for a very long time, and you look in there where the writers will reference something that happened 50 issues ago in the editor's note. Mm-hmm. To a new reader, that scares the crap out of them.
Well, the other thing that they should be doing, and I know that Marvel started to do it, is they printed like the Essential Spider-Man or the Essential Fantastic Four and reprinted them in black and white format and gave you an omnibus for a fraction of the costs where you could actually go back and check out all these old stories. So I think, you know, if as a strong marketing plan to do away with the fear of having all that quote-unquote past baggage is you go back to them with, here is a reprinting that is affordable to you, the young reader, and you can get caught up on this. So, you know, that, I think that there are ways to do it and do it smartly. Smartly, is that a word? To do it well.
It is now.
And not destroy a portion of your fan base that has been loyal for a long period of time. And, you know, and like I said, those companies owe me nothing. Yeah. But I'm just saddened that, you know, with the choices they made, I had to make a choice too, and that was to not give them my money anymore. So
Okay, Gregor, final, you get the final word. Go ahead.
So real quick for Spider-Man fans, because Ryan mentioned Spider-Man, the two books out there, Amazing Spider-Man, is a little bit of Tony Stark and Iron Man, like it's Tony Stark and Spider-Man, sorry, where it's like Spider-Man with this big company focusing more on the world and less on New York City or just Queens, New York, and the Spider-Man book, which is written by Brian Michael Bendis, who he's wrote Miles Morales, I think, for the whole time. It's him filling in Peter's role again, in a manner of speaking, but this time in the Marvel proper universe, not the Ultimates universe that is just full of so much confusion that it would make a grown man cry.
Okay, I have a question real quick. How did Miles Morales get from the Ultimates universe to the main Marvel universe? Was that part of...
Of Secret War right now. Okay. So the basic premise to Secret War, this version has been, I think it's the zero issue or issue number one, because they've been doing before, Jonathan Hickman has been doing this thing with Avengers and New Avengers where Earths from multiple universes were colliding into each other, and if they collide, those two Earths are destroyed. So it's been leading up to this end where it was the regular Marvel universe, or Marvel 616, and then the Ultimate Marvel universe, Marvel 1610. They collide, and in that moment, Doctor Doom creates Battle World with Doctor Strange, and makes himself God, and basically does it a lot of it in his image, like how he sees fit. There are other little ways that came in, like the way Miles Morales was introduced is he was on a quote unquote life raft that brought him along with a few other people in there, still having memories of before. So it's like there's like a small handful of people, Doctor Strange, Doctor Doom, like Star-Lord, Captain Marvel, Peter Parker, Miles Morales, all knowing what there is. Meanwhile, there are other versions in these other books that you will see, which are really just there for really good storytelling. Like there's like three or four different Captain Marvels, a whole slew of Captain Americas. And it's just they're more for telling stories like in a certain different time period or, you know, alternate dimension sort of deal, but all on one planet.
Okay. I think I understand. After all this, I think we all could use a drink, right?
Oh, yes.
Okay. How about our geek drink of the week? You guys ready for this?
Yes.
You might want to write this down if you're a drinker. So it's called the Metroid Cocktail. I thought since we have Ryan on, we'll do a video game related geek drink of the week. Metroid. Does anybody who's familiar with that want to just briefly give a quick synopsis of what Metroid was or is?
She's the best character in Super Smash Brothers.
Samus is not Metroid. It's funny. I not only did you pick a video game, but you picked probably a Nintendo property and a very underappreciated Nintendo property, even by its own developers at Nintendo. I mean, there's this big kerfuffle about E3. We're not getting a new Metroid game, and Nintendo's not interested in giving us a new Metroid game, at least one that's a Metroid proper. So Metroid is a game where you play as Samus Aran, you're a bounty hunter, and the first few games center around extinguishing a parasitic life form known as Metroid, which are life-sucking, weird jellyfish with beaks, which is sort of how it goes. So I'm more than happy to be talking about Metroid because Nintendo certainly isn't interested in doing that.
You're interested in talking about Metroid because Nintendo's not.
Yeah.
So this is the next best thing, then, the Metroid cocktail.
Yeah, I mean, if I can't play Metroid games, I might as well drink them, right? Like, that's it's a good way to pass time, right? Alcohol, the best time passer there is.
Okay,
that's not true, kids.
Here's the ingredients. Half shot Bacardi Big Apple rum, half shot coconut rum, half glass kiwi strawberry Minute Maid or Kool-Aid, a little less than half a glass of Sprite, and three strawberries. And what you do is shake the two rums and kiwi strawberry Minute Maid and pour into a lowball glass, whatever the hell a lowball glass is, I have no idea. Add the Sprite for a bit of flavor and carbonation. Drop in three strawberries as a garnish. If you choose, you can use your ice beam freezer to cool the alcohol before you make the drinks. And this comes from the Drunken Moogle.
A lowball glass is like one of the shorter, round tumblers.
Oh, the ones you would see the one in the picture, but I think it's the one that you'd see like Frank Sinatra drinking out of.
Okay.
Like a small, you know, one finger of scotch would be in a lowball.
Got it. All right. So anybody out there listening, want to make that cocktail and give us feedback, galacticnetcasts@gmail.com. Call our voicemail number, 805-328-3966, or gncasts.com, and click on the leave us a voice message and let us know how the Metroid cocktail was. It sounds kind of delicious. I don't know. It looks cool, too. Mm-hmm. Can't play the game. Might as well drink the cocktail.
Exactly. No, I'm not a big drink mixer. I'll occasionally have a beer here and there. But looking at this picture, it's pretty rad. Kind of want one. Do you think if I go to I have a wedding. I'm going to a wedding on Saturday. Do you think if I walk up to the bar and say, "Give me a double shot of Metroid," and they'll be like, "I'm sorry, but Nintendo's not interested in providing that product for you."
No, I don't know.
Probably have as much luck as I did when I was 21 and I went to a bar and I said, "I'd like a Vulcan neck pinch, please."
You did that? Really?
Sir, you're going to want the massage parlor down the street for that, sir. We do not do that kind of thing here.
There's a lot going on with this one. So they might have most of it. The rum, coconut rum, Bacardi Big Apple rum, that seems pretty kind of obscure. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't foresee
on the drinks
drinking that... more coconut rum.
So here's what you do. You come in there with the Bacardi Big Apple rum, and you go, okay, take this. You got some coconut rum back there? Okay, good. And go get the strawberry kiwi Minute Maid or Kool-Aid from the kids' table. And then go, okay, mix all this together with a Sprite and give me three strawberries.
Yeah, don't. They got to have the Sprite.
But what kind of bar are you guys at that you can actually explain things to? You're like, what? You want a coconut of your rum? What?
This isn't how bars work?
No, yeah, you got to yell.
Sadly, no.
You got to get right up in their ear and like, tickle their eardrum to get anything. I don't know.
Can you tell I don't drink alcohol?
What kind of bar you go to?
I guess.
You could tell them a drink, and they'd be like, "I'm not familiar with it. Do you know how to make it?" I'm like, "Yeah." And then you tell them the ingredients, and they're like, "Boom, here it is."
Oh yeah, yeah. Well,
so, I mean, I guess it depends on how friendly your bartenders are.
From all the episodes of Bar Rescue I've watched, if you're a good bartender, you will figure out this drink and make it for the customer.
Perfect. I will test it.
All right. Hey, let's move on to sci-fi recommendations this week. This is totally an optional thing within our guests and our what are we called? The rest of us, panelists, hosts, whatever. Just something sci-fi related that we watched or whatever, watched, read, what have you. And my recommendation is a book that probably took me 4 or 5 months to read, and not because it's a badly written book, it's just because I read really slow. And it's called Station 11 by Emily St. John Mandel. She's a Canadian writer that's based out of New York City. And it's a post-apocalyptic, dystopian future type book where there's all these characters, and they're all spread out all over the place, and she tells the story not necessarily in chronological order, but she kind of just goes ahead in time, goes back in time, And then you eventually see the pattern take shape and the characters kind of meet each other and you connect the dots, and it's really cool. It's about a symphony orchestra that basically the most interesting part of this whole story is it's about a symphony orchestra who also does plays that goes from town to town and entertains people after this big global catastrophe that happened that wiped out most of the population of the world. It's really cool with a lot of neat science fiction references. They mention Star Trek a lot in this book. And that's my recommendation. It's called Station 11. And I'm sure that you will enjoy it. If you like post-apocalyptic books, I think you'll dig this one. Cool. Looks like Gregor's got one.
Yes, and I just realized, because I mentioned Jeff Lemire a little bit ago, Jeff Lemire, Canadian comic book writer, based out of Toronto, and he has a comic book through Image, which is the creator-owned series, their company, called Descender. And this one is basically you follow a little boy robot in this futuristic world. He's on a mining planet, and there's this bill where or law or whatever where robots aren't exactly liked anymore. They're more feared. And he's just this sweet little innocent boy named Tim 21, I want to say. And it's just him surviving. It's really good. I love the art by Dustin Nguyen. And it's really well written. They are before the first volume yet. So you have to get the first five issues. The fifth issue came out this past Wednesday, and it's just good. Like I highly recommend this book. It's I loved it. Love it. It's still going on. So
cool.
Looks cool.
All right. So we did a book. We did a comic book. And Ryan, what do you got?
Well, of course, it wouldn't be Ryan speaking out loud without mentioning video games. So, and I literally just came off playing Ark for Gamers End Game Night, and I will start this conversation off with the fact that I do not like open world survival crafting. You're in the world, do your thing. You know, I don't like that. I need objectives. I need some sort of like objective, not just go. So having said that, I'm not a big fan of Ark. The screenshots make it look really cool, and I thought maybe this is the one that gets me to like survival games. But again, I think this game is relegated to here's a cool 2-minute video from Ark, and I think that's where it starts and stops for me, having played 2 hours and didn't really dig it. But that being said, for those of you who are interested in open-world survival games, yes, like you like Rust, you like DayZ, and you want to try one that's actually competent, Ark is... this just launched last month, and it's solid for what it is, you know, for that type of game. It plays well, it looks great, the animations are okay. The mechanics are easy enough to understand. In terms of early access and open world survival, this game has got it going on. Like it's kind of the best that I've played. Hasn't changed my opinion. That's like saying to somebody like, oh, you don't like first person shooters? Well, try this one. It's going to change the way you think about first person shooters. Like, no, it's still a first person shooter. You know, you're not going to change your mind. So that's why it's sort of a partial recommendation. If you have not liked open world survival games in the past, this one's going to try to change it, but it won't. It'll be like, oh, this is a lot better than the ones I've played. But if you do like them, definitely look up Ark, because it is the current hotness in that genre right now.
Now, is Ark still in the Steam Early Access, or are they out of that?
It is still in early access, okay. And it is $32.99 Canadian, so it's probably $29.99 American.
Yep.
Guessing. Yeah.
And it is in early access. And if you look at the screenshots, you're seeing people riding dinosaurs. You're seeing people with spears and guns. But really, the first 2 hours were literally me punching a turtle. and then deciding to get on top of that turtle and then having a saber tooth fight my turtle. And again, it's all about making your own story. So after a while, it's like, well, I'm just going to go make my own story. I'm going to go jump on this. And then I was killed by some dude with a hatchet. So it's just like all those other games, but looks better and has dinosaurs.
Yeah. And where I think with the difference between, what's the one zombie game everyone's playing? Is it DayZ? Yeah, DayZ is, it doesn't look like DayZ is going to be fully developed anytime soon. Like, they just sort of gave up on it. This has more promise to me from what my friends that are playing it have said. This one looks like it has more promise.
I could see them actually finishing this game. I think your feeling on that is accurate. And when I played DayZ a while ago, it was like a year and a half ago, and I hated it. It felt like a slapping match between me and my friend. But again, that was only the first 2 hours, and first impressions for me are everything with the limited time I have to play games. But if I go back and play that game right now, it's going to be the exact same thing, except maybe the weather effects are a little better, right? To me, again, that's why I feel kind of bad, like, poo-pooing it, which is kind of funny if you were watching the stream, because you can poo-poo in that game. I think if you're into that sort of game, this is something you should check out.
But, all right.
Yeah, Ark.
Cool. Brad and Anessa, you don't have anything written down here in the doc. Do you have any recommendations?
We just got our poster of Shia Who. You want to grab the other side? Yeah. And this is purely nice. Visual.
Yeah, if you want to see this, check out the video on the YouTube channel, youtube.com/galacticnetcasts.
And an artist painted individual images of Shia LaBeouf as all the different doctors. And then created a poster print collecting all of them, and that is what we have, and that's what we'll be putting up in the Nerdatorium here in the near future. Shia Who.
I'm sorry, but the Matt Smith one still to me looks like Matt Smith. I don't know if it's just like the...
Well, the mustache. You know, what he definitely does is keeps the facial structure of Shia, but like the hair will be that closer to the original actor. Or trying to make Shia's, what he envisions Shia's hair, if grown out, could look as close as possible to that particular doctor.
Yeah.
And poor Shia.
Yeah. But it's just, I don't, it was so funny to me. I'm like, well, here's my $15. Go ahead.
Yeah, it looks really cool.
No, I actually like Shia better now than before.
Yeah.
Just some of the random stuff that he's been doing since he's...
So you didn't like the Transformer Shia LaBeouf. You like the badass kind of damaged Shia LaBeouf a little bit.
Yeah, just do
it. Yeah, I suppose so. I mean, he's just done a bunch of, like, little quirky projects, and I enjoy that.
Yeah. I'm sorry, but give me Even Stevens Shia LaBeouf any day.
I was going to say, he's living off that Even Stevens money.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Actually, no, I think that might have dried up by now. It's probably the Holes money.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's probably actually the Indiana Jones money. He was probably really banking that he'd be taking over that franchise. What was his name? Wooly or
Mutt?
Muffy or...
Mutt.
It's definitely not Muffy.
No, hold on. Are you admitting that you've seen that movie?
I have. Of course I have. There's ants. They eat people. Spoilers.
Because I'm sorry, there are some movies I don't even claim that I've seen. You know, because
I've seen it, but I don't claim it as Indiana Jones.
It's a new Indiana Jones movie. You actually watch it, you know? You don't know if it's a piece of crap.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And honestly, I didn't really have a huge issue with the alien twist with the crystal skull or anything, because that was a thing before Indiana Jones ever...
Yeah.
Came out. I mean, that was kind of, some people had this theory that it was actually aliens that created these crystal skulls, and so I was totally fine with that.
Hmm.
I just, for some reason, wasn't really into Shia LaBeouf being part of the movie and being like, oh, hey, that's your son. We're going to hint at it all movie, because Indy took the name of a dog, and so we're just going to flat out call your son Mutt. And I think if they had kind of done away with that little bit of the movie, I think I would have enjoyed it better.
Is there like a machete edit where the Crystal Skull they just get rid of all the gopher scenes and maybe the monkeys and the swinging monkeys? Is that not, that is it, Crystal Skull, right?
The swinging monkeys?
Are there monkeys? Or like were mutts up swinging trying to get a jeep or something?
Yeah.
I've blocked half of it out.
Yeah.
I was gonna say I'm sorry. I don't know why we're talking about this.
You're bringing back totally flashbacks. You're giving us flashbacks, guys.
No.
Poor Brad's having a panic attack. Like I don't want to talk about this.
No, I've shut down.
He's done.
All right. Hey, let's talk about some feedback here. Alyssa on YouTube, Alyssa Brenner, chimed in on a couple of our videos. She said, just discovered this as I was looking for an interview with Andy Weir after being blown away by his book, of course, The Martian. He's as funny in real life as I expected, but now I've discovered so are the rest of you. Thanks, Alyssa.
Oh, thanks.
I'll be checking out some other episodes now and following you guys in the future. Thanks. And then she chimed in later on, said, glad I found you guys recently. Interesting stuff. Though I've got to say, I miss having Brad and Vanessa on separate cameras. I can't really see either now, especially not in the bottom panel. I like the reaction shots.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to get like a second computer over here so that we can run video off of. Even if I use the my camera, mini cam. That's going to bog down my computer pretty bad if I try to fire that up and run video for the both of us.
Yeah, Brad, I totally understand trying to run anything while you're doing a hangout, because I actually brought my second computer down here tonight to look at the show notes, because it's so hard to go back and forth between anything if you're running a hangout, especially if your computer sucks.
Yeah, well, no. my computer's pretty hardcore. It's an i7 processor. It needs some more RAM, but I mean, still, it's you start throwing on two cameras worth of video and
what are we talking about here production wise? I mean, look, I got two screens here for one computer. I got my Mac, which has show notes, and I got these here too. I mean, come on.
Hey, Gregor, that's weird.
On an Andy Weir note, I'm sure I've mentioned it in a previous episode, but if, was it Alicia?
Yeah.
Brenner? In case you missed it, Science Friday, the podcast from PRI, they do an interview with him, or they did an interview with him back in 2014, and it came out, I think, February or March, which is when I had first heard about The Martian. And I recommend giving that particular podcast to listen for the interview. So
if I have a related thing. I saw Hugh Howey posted on Facebook tonight that he's at San Diego Comic-Con right now, but tonight he was going to meet Andy Weir and what's his face from Ready Player, Ernest Klein. Meeting Ernest Klein and Andy Weir for drinks tonight at San Diego Comic Con. We've had all two of those three people on this podcast.
Oh, that's right. Never mind. I was confusing. Who's coming out in October?
That's Andy Weir. We're getting
Andy Weir's coming back.
Yeah, he's coming back. Yeah.
No, I thought we were gonna have somebody else that was had not been on, but.
I think I told you I was working on something, but it never happened.
Oh, shoot. Okay, never mind.
Yeah. All right, guys, that's it. Thank you, Ryan Murphy, for your final guest geek spot. From now on, you'll be a guest host. Before we get out of here, why don't you tell people where they can find you and all your stuff online?
Well, first and foremost, of course, I have to mention Galactic Gaming News, which goes up every Tuesday. It's going to happen every Tuesday. Sometimes it slips to Wednesday or Thursday, but I do try to release every Tuesday where I break down the three top stories in gaming for sci-fi and sometimes fantasy. I know I apologize. Sometimes Davis told me fantasy's all right, you know, as long as it's not all the time, right? But
see, I don't mind it because I have your Galactic Gaming News in Adventure Party during our news section. So and we deal with a lot of fantasies. So.
You know, Ryan, as long as it's a nice balance, you can throw in as much fantasy as you want. Go ahead.
So I shouldn't have like a fantasy week where I just talk about The Witcher 3 for 4 minutes. That'd be pushing it, right?
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, maybe.
All right.
I have norm to talk. My skills are not. I'm surprised Dave has not yelled at me like you're going too much Marvel.
Yeah. Come on, it's balanced. Marvel, DC. If you want to find everything else I do, the best place is RyanMurphy.ca, which is sort of my hub, where you can find it all about different podcasts. I do need to add Galactic Gaming News to it. I'm so busy. I just that thing needs to be updated. But yeah, that's Gamers In, Zombies Ate My Podcast, Sleeping with the Elephant, all that fun stuff we covered at the top of the show. Listen and let me know what you think, because always looking for new opinions on shows that have been around for multiple years, you know.
And of course, we've got Fear the Walking Dead coming up. That's I'm super excited for that show. That's going to be awesome.
We're super excited for that. Lou, funny enough, who's usually a big fan of all things zombie, is kind of skeptical because, and I agree with him, the marketing team behind AMC doesn't seem to be, I mean, it's Walking Dead, right? So you kind of get by on the name alone, but the marketing is at least something to be desired. I mean, the first teaser video was just this dude with his shirt open running and screaming. He looks scared, but I mean, we've been through 6 seasons of The Walking Dead. We kind of, you know, zombies. We know zombies, right? So it'll be interesting to see, and of course we'll be there covering every last bit of zombie news.
Cool. All right. Thanks, Brian. And Gregor, what your website one more time for...
elsenerds.com.
Tired. Sorry.
Yeah, no. Elsenerds.com, ELSENERDS.com. That's the hub page for all of our podcasts that we do. if I get enough motivation and enough people like want to hear the other stuff, I might start them back up. And then, of course, I do the splash page blog and splash page podcast here on GNcast. And then I'm on Twitter at ThatGregor.
All right. Thanks, Gregor. Thanks, Ryan. And on behalf of Brad and Essa, Matt, and everybody else, thanks for listening, everybody. We'll talk to you next time.
Bye, Dad.
Bye, Dad.
Bye, Dad. Darn, I was going to say it first.